Hi guys, I'm here in Shenzhen, next to the border, just over the border from Hong Kong in China. Absolutely crazy. What a huge city this is. So many skyscrapers. Some areas are really very high tech. So clean. I didn't expect this at all, but the air is very clean. And it's very easy to see why all motorcycles, the small scooters, they are all electrical. And all buses are also electrical. Only the cars drive on petroleum, and they're all new cars. There are no old cars. So yeah, it's all very clean. But of course, it also makes me realize the amount of money that is present in the world. And of course, many of that capital will flow into cryptocurrency. But it won't be the currencies that we are seeing today in the market. I'm pretty sure of that. Maybe a few of them will make it if they continue to change and adapt to market realities. But the way most cryptos are developed is they are very fixed in their designs, and nothing really changes since it's invented. The fundamentals all stay the same. They don't really reinvent themselves, and that's maybe not necessary. Usually what you see in a new market is that the ones that get it right, they conquer the whole market, and the other ones just drop off the map. That was the case with Windows, or I mean, in personal computers. They were all trying to get the market by building the best personal computer and creating their own operating system. But there was one smart man that thought that he shouldn't be focusing on building the computer himself, but just on the operating system. And he should make sure that most people have the operating system are using the operating system, even if he's not making much money on it. They should be using his system and not someone else's. And that was, of course, Bill Gates from Microsoft, who made deals with these manufacturers that they don't have to create their own operating system anymore. They could use his operating system, and they only need to pay one fixed price, and they could sell as many personal computers as they wanted. They didn't need to pay anything more. So he was basically selling, at the time it was about $50,000 or so, early 80s. I don't know the exact numbers, but the amounts were very good deals for the computer manufacturers. Like at the time, they had Lotus, Atari, what were the names? I forgot them, but like Commodore and all these guys, they started, well, buying his operating system and making huge profits because they only need to pay a fixed fee. But he was smart, Bill Gates, and of course it was a thought-out strategy to keep the copyright, and so, I mean, in the future the rules changed. The moment he had market dominance and people bought personal computers because it had Windows, not because it was a Commodore or an Atari, but because it had MS-DOS at the time, and they were familiar with MS-DOS, so they wanted a personal computer that had MS-DOS, and so he was able to start charging a fee in a different way by asking per sold computer they need to pay money to Microsoft, the computer manufacturers, and that's of course when the fortune was created. But the basis of the fortune was created much earlier, when he was giving away almost for free his computer operating system. That's of course the same that needs to happen today with cryptocurrencies. You need to give them, well, you need to really like make sure it's in the hands of the people and they start using it. And even if that costs you money via free transaction fees or free distributions of the coins, it all doesn't matter how you do it. But what's important is that it gets into the hands of the people. And today, who is doing that? I mean, Bitcoin you have to pay, you have to buy. People still do it because it's a good investment, so they are willing to do that. But yeah, it's very important you have free transactions. So yeah, that's the situation. And but I think I'm not sure who's laying the right foundations for to win the market today. Biteball will do a free giveaway to all people that install wallets in the future. So that's great perspective and a great idea. But Biteball is still a lot of problems with its wallet. You have a lot of you have to upgrade it a lot, and often there are issues. Tony, the lead dev, is doing a great job with trying to fix those issues and fixing them. But still, this is clearly not ready for mass market adoption. But the direction is at least right. It's an Android wallet, needs to be a mobile phone wallet. It needs to be able to be installed easily and used easily. That's done well, but it's still too many bugs. In China, many people use WeChat to pay. You can pay everywhere with WeChat. That's not a cryptocurrency, it's just it started as a chat app comparable to WhatsApp, but you can do a lot of other things in the app. It's a bit comparable to Facebook, but it's also used to pay everywhere. But it's not its own currency, it's just you charge it up with your bank account, but most people, they just get paid by other people via WeChat, or merchants get paid with WeChat and then they leave the balance on WeChat and they use that to pay other places. But there is a strong network effect with these payment systems. WeChat has really become extremely big here, but it has grown rapidly. I heard that only 2 years ago a few had it, and then now everybody has it. So it's has seen amazing growth. And the same will happen with probably some of these cryptocurrencies if they are ready. If they are really simple to use, it's very important. I have to say it's a little bit frightening having sold so much crypto for fiat. Fiat is a terrible long-term investment. Every year you lose 5% of the purchasing power. So I started selling crypto for cash at the start of the year, January, and decent amounts in starting at March. So we're already half a year in and I haven't invested this in anything else. So it's just losing value. And now that's about half a year, that means 2.5% of what I sold for fiat. Well, the fiat lost already 2.5% now. That counts, that adds up. So that's a big problem when you cash out. And of course you have taxation sometimes also, that can be a problem. So I agree that it's not very easy to cash out, and it's often leads to just loss in opportunity. So I have these fears too. I try to be as rational as possible when investing, and I think, well, yeah, I am invested today 30% in crypto, and I would like all these people commenting on my YouTube channel, because there's so many people these days that say that I'm doing it wrong, and it's really I'm just very wrong and cashing out and having a minority in crypto these days and a majority in cash. But I would like to hear from the same people then, when is it justified to have a minority in crypto? And because if they say never, then I could agree with that in the long term. Never, that's true, because in the long term, the risk-reward ratio of crypto is much better than most other investments. So you should have a majority exposed to the best investment, and that's crypto, I agree. But shouldn't you also take into account short-term returns? Because, it does count, right? If you lose a lot of money in the short term, you can say to yourself, but in the long term all will be well, and that might be true, but you don't know that for sure. If in the short term you've lost half your money or more, then that's a problem. So, I don't know, this guy is just So, what else? So if you agree with me that you do have to take into account the short term also, and that you agree with me that sometimes the short term looks very bad in crypto, do you agree with that or not? And okay, if you don't agree with that, yeah, we just disagree, because sometimes the short term does look very bad for a cryptocurrency. Sometimes in the past it has collapsed with 90%, and so unless you think the future can be very different than the past, yeah, okay, but I mean, I disagree there again. I mean, the future often will be just like the past. It will just repeat, but in different ways. So I think strong corrections are likely. It's just very hard to predict when. And I have to admit that I might be wrong in my estimation how high this bubble will go. If I always compare different bubbles, but in 2013, for example, I always looked at this as two bubbles. But you could also look at this as one bubble, where you basically went up from the $3, and then it went up to $10 in 2012, so that was basically a recovery. But then in 2012 it went up from $10 to, in 2013 it went up from $10 to $1,150, that was a peak. So you could see that as one bubble with just a correction of about 3-4 months and then a continuation. And so if you look at that rise, that's tremendous. That's basically, if you compare it, then you have the old all-time high of $30 versus the new all-time high of $1,150. So that's times 30. So that's a bubble that's comparable to the first bubble in 2011, where it also went times 30, but only in 2 months. Here in 2013, it went times 30 in not 2 months, but 12 months. Something like that. No, a little bit more. Actually, it was 16 months. Even more. It was 18 months. So in 18 months, it went times 30, and it went. That happened in 2 months in 2011. So we could see the same now, times 30, but not maybe in 18 months, but in like double that, 10, 20, 30. So maybe 30, 40 months. So that's like 2-3 years that it just continues to go up, with from time to time a sideways correction. It could be like that too, and so that means that we go a lot higher over the next 2-3 years, and there will be, well, very few opportunities to really buy back in with your fiat, so that's certainly possible. So I don't know myself. I just have to look at what's the situation, and I have to balance accordingly, and I might have overdone it, but I think it's certainly the right direction to scale out of crypto. We certainly are a lot higher today than 18 months ago, when we found the bottom for Bitcoin at $160. So I think the only question is, like, how much percent do you need to expose to crypto today? And that also depends on the other investments you have in your portfolio. If you're still invested 100% in crypto today, or 90 or 95, like, that's really, to me, that looks really out of touch with the reality of the risks that there are today in the short term. Not in the long term, but in the short term. So voila, I'm always repeating myself with the same message. And that's just what's investing. It can take quite some time that you have to go against the market, against what the market is thinking, and you can be wrong for quite some time. But it's the long-term returns that count, not the short-term returns. And of course, the amount of capital, of course, plays too. It's true that my capital has grown a lot, and these are not, like, that's not play money. It's not something I want to lose. I've worked a lot, very, very hard to become a successful investor, and I don't want to start from zero again. So that plays, of course, too. But I do think that the way to invest is very comparable for people with a little bit of amount of money or people with a lot of money. It always comes down to investing the most in the best risk reward ratio investments, and that analysis should be done for the long term as well as the short term. Bye guys.